Okay, so we are at the end of the work package 4, and we will focus here on the deliverable 4.4, which focuses on the world effect on EU policies on food security. So it concerns many different policies, food aid, EU aid, trade policies. And Luca will first present his work on preferential trade policies, and then I will summarize two other works because the authors are not present today. And you have had a preview of this deliverable yesterday evening with the presentation of Yo. So Luca, you can start.
Okay, thanks Christophe. How does it work with this one? Okay. So basically, this is part of Work Package 4, though to be honest, the division between Work Package 4 and 11 is not somewhat so clear as it was ex-ante when the project was written. So finally, we decided to put these two papers from Roma 3 Unit of Research under this Work Package. And they are somewhat related in terms of the topics about the EU preferential policies. The first one is a work by Valentina Raimondi, Margherita Scopo, and Alessandro Holper that you already heard by Jos Wiener, so it's a research that is active in different teams in this project. And this is about the impact of European Union preferential policies in the rice industry, a dynamic panel-gravity approach. This is a food security working paper and has also been published on the Review of World Economics. The other is a joint work with Maria Cipollina and David Laborde, which is also in the room and will be happy to answer all the questions you have, I'm sure. And myself, The Tide Doesn't Rise of Boats, an assessment of EU preferential trade policies. So this is a working paper that we are trying to publish somewhere, but it's not an easy task. What is the motivation? Well, just briefly, in terms of erosion preferences, there is a long-standing concern in terms of the multilateral negotiation, even if perhaps it is not so urgent if multilateral negotiations are not going to happen anytime. Anyway, in 2003 there was a CAP reform regarding the rice policy, and this provided a natural experiment, if you want, that could shed some light in terms of what would have been the impact in terms of preference erosion. On the other hand, more generally, as it was mentioned in the previous session, trade policy are believed and do have international trade and trade policies an impact on food security and many other dimensions, and there is quite a debate about that. Basically, you have two types of criticism. One is these policies are ineffective, the other that they could be even harmful. Of course, if something is ineffective, it cannot be harmful at the same time, but basically we provide <Some black. laughs> we provide some evidence about what is the effectiveness or not of these policies. Now, in terms of the first paper, this is the emphasis on tariff rate quotas, which was the instrument in terms of preferences granted to rice imports in the EU. And the twist in the contribution of the paper is to take into account what are the implications, the consequences of introducing fixed costs and imperfect competition in the way you model trade preferences. And they use a dynamic panel gravity model to account for. In terms of the preference definition, here you have the formula, and basically you have in the numerator the difference between the most favored nation tariff, and the preferential tariff. And this is made relative in terms of 1 plus the preferential tariff. Now, the major point is how do you define the preferential tariff in this case? You have two different tariffs in quota and out of quota. The point that Scopola, Holper and Raimondi makes is that even the in quota tariff should take into account the fact that you have economies of scale in terms of computing what is the level. And basically the point that's made in the paper is that if you have this type of non-perfect competition structure, the preferential tariff in quota is lower than what you compute usually in terms of perfect competition, and this implies that the preferential margin is larger. And this means that if you use the wrong assumption, you get an underestimation of the preferential margin, and also in terms of the impact of preference, the amount and the impact of preference erosion. In terms of the second paper, then we go to the second paper. This is what they find with this different assumption, and they do find some evidence that there was preference erosion, especially for ACP countries and Bangladesh after 2004 for the CFP rice reform. Now, in the case of the other paper, the major point is not about the preferential tariff, which is the small t in the formula. Rather, the point is how do you define the reference tariff, the multilateral one, if you want. And we make the point that as the preferential tariff is a bilateral applied tariff, also the reference tariff is not unique, is bilateral. And the point is just the intuition is the same as in terms of any trade cost, distance cost. It doesn't matter really the absolute level of the cost, but it matters what is the relative cost with respect to the other possible competitors. And changing this assumption makes quite a big difference, because at this point you could have some preferences that are not really preferences, because there could be some other competitors that are more preferred than you. And it points out that basically, in a sense, there is no free lunch, and it's certainly a zero-sum game. If you give some positive preference to some exporter, you, in a sense, by definition, give negative preference to someone else. This is the graph of this intuition. So basically, in principle, and this is also what maintained in the other paper, you could consider a fixed reference as the most favored nation, and then you have your preferential tariff. But then, if you consider rather your benchmark not the multilateral tariff, but the average of what the other competitors pay, and then there is a whole issue about how you compute this average, then you discover that even if you have a preferential tariff, the others could, on average, pay less than you. And in this case, you would have a negative margin. The consequences of that are quite relevant. Because at this point you have both positive and negative margin, and you have trade creation coming from trade creation in the sense of new trade flows coming from preferential policies, but you also have trade destruction, and these are the negative trade flows that you see below the zero line. These are the different sections of the for different sectors that we estimate. Of course, the absolute amount depends on the margin size, on the margin sign, positive or negative, and on the elasticity value that we estimate in terms of the reaction of trade flows to the change in the margin, and of course also, as in the case of textiles, number 11, the absolute size of the sectors. The point is that the net overall impact is quite trivial, but just to keep this in perspective, this is only about substitution between different exporters, so we don't need to account the possible trade creation, the real trade creation effect in terms of displacing some possible less efficient domestic producers. So it's only a substitution effect between different exporters. Trying to summarize the main findings of the first paper, the major point was in terms of the margin definition and pointing out the possible overestimation that you get if you simply assume perfect competition and constant redundant to scale. And in terms of the policy implication from the point of view of preference erosion, there is some evidence that domestic reform, not even waiting for multilateral agreement, can have an impact on preference erosion. In the case of the second paper, again, there is some common, even if the approach is quite different. As you saw, in one case, they focus on the applied preferential tariff. In our case, we focus on the definition of the reference tariff. But also in this case, we show that it's important to focus on the margin definition. The aggregate impact seems to be trivial, but as I mentioned before, this is a lower bound because it always takes account the substitution impact, and the differences across sectors are significant. So in some sectors, it's not trivial at all. If I still have some minutes left, just to put this in perspective, We don't provide, this type of results don't provide an answer from the normative point of view if preferential trade policies are a good or a bad thing. They only provide a better answer, we believe, to the question if they are effective or not. But more generally, you can also ask yourself what this has to do with food security. Well, basically, just to try to have even broader picture, you can have a lot of different possible approach. So you can have case studies, there is a whole qualitative literature that already been mentioned. You can have econometric analysis, and this is where this contribution are in terms of the literature. And then you can have, of course, equilibrium models. Now, in terms of where is the food security would be the next step. You have some possibilities of trying to do the direct link between trade policies and food security. This was done, for example, in the work mentioned by Yo in terms of the synthetic control. We have been doing some work ourselves in World Package 11 in this respect, but basically we are in the first step. The link between trade policies and trade comes in terms of trade flows. And then, of course, you would need another step to see what does it mean in terms of food security. And in this respect, there are a lot of different dimensions. Alan already mentioned these kind of meetings going on at the FAO now, looking at the implication and the links between trade and food security. And of course, trade flows have a direct impact, especially on one of the usual dimensions, which is availability. And this is my last slide. I think this was done in, perhaps by Venedis Bonilla, not drinking beer in Leuven, but there are a lot of different links, and I put in red what we are doing now. This is just one of the boxes. And of course, the picture is much more complex, but there are other papers in the project that are exploring the other possible links. I think that I can stop here.
Thank you, Luca. As you said, the difference between Work Package 4 and Work Package 11 is quite narrow. We have a bit of a gray area. Work Package 4 was more on was supposed to be more on what is currently existing in terms of EU policies, and 11 how we could reform it. But in practice, it's a bit shady. So we have some complements to this approach, especially with general equilibrium models, which are actually in Work Package 11. The main reason is the initial allocation of time between the two work packages. This is not really a scientific logic to have it in Work Package 11, because it's more than what is existing in terms of the balance of the preferential agreements of the EU. So that will be presented sometimes later.